Ken Anderson is an artist who sees the world differently than most people.
I've always been very fascinated by the fact that these trees look like they're, to me, like they're in a blasted movement. Here they are growing out of the ground, but they're just growing at a different time, at a different tempo, a different synchronization from human beings. I believe they're all in movement. They all look like they're dancing, ballet dancing.
In 1962, Ken Anderson suffered a stroke, and these oak trees in California's Descanso Gardens saved his life.
It certainly means life to me. I just love this place. I come here every time I can, every moment I can. I love this place.
Walt Disney called Ken Anderson his jack of all trades. As a world traveler, he has an eye for the exotic. The snapshot sketches he made on his travels often became cartoon characters. His technical innovations made Disney animation less expensive and gave it new life.
Look, Pongo. Anita!
And his artistic leadership helped the animators carry on after the death of Walt Disney.
Yeah.
Ken Anderson draws on everything around him for his work, his art, his life. This is his story in a Disney family album. Ken Anderson began his life with Disney after he was laid off from MGM's art department in 1934.
They said, well, stick by the phone, kid. We like your work and you'll be called back. So I had confidently gotten married. And we spent the week, or the month, really, living on the beaches and with canned beans and whatnot. So one day we were just riding around the city and I was more or less oblivious to any problems when we went by this place in East Hollywood. And there was a big signs of Mickey Mouse and Sully Symphonies, and Polly said, why don't you go in there and get a job? And I said, well, I can't cartoon. I'm an architect and sketch artist. I don't know anything about cartooning. She said, well, go on in there and get a job. I said, we need a job? Yeah, we need a job.
Impressed by Anderson's paintings of his European travels, Disney hired him as an in-betweener.
The first picture I ever worked on was the Goddess of Spring.
Wasn't long before Ken was adding his special touch to the Disney cartoons.
It was called Ferdinand the Bull. And Ferdinand the Bull was the bull who liked it better to just smell flowers. He was a pacifist bull who didn't really want to get involved in a bullfight. I had been a recipient of an architectural fellowship, and I'd traveled through Europe, and I was just slayed by the beautiful colors and the beautiful architecture and the people and everything, and particularly in Spain. And the hot colors, and here was a chance on a new picture. It was Ferdinand the Bull. It was in Spain to really have some color in it. And prior to this time, it was uneconomical, and actually the word was out that Walt didn't want any painting. He wanted tints. So you could unroll a long roll of paper and just put blue tints for the sky and very soft tints so that no matter where the little characters went, they were going to read. Spain was a hot country, it had reflected lights, and the light bounced off the ground even through the shadow and showed underlit areas and shadows, and it was hot color. It was a hot country, and it should be painted. So to do what I was proposing to do meant that you had to carefully make sure that wherever these characters went, they worked with these paintings, if we could paint the backgrounds. Well, the head of the background department let it be known that that Walt hated it. In fact, he was certain that Walt hated two things, purple. Never use anything purple, and also don't paint it. It can't be painted. There's no way it's going to work. And the time it happened that Walt was gone, Walt was in Europe, and so Walt came back and he saw it and he loved it.
When he got to the middle of the range, he sat down just quietly and smelled.
Walt Disney had a knack of finding the specialties of his artists, as Anderson learned when Disney asked him to work on Three Orphan Kittens.
Walt found out that I knew perspective early on in my animation business. So he sidetracked me. He said, Ken, he said, I want these three little kittens, which is a picture I was doing assistant animation on, these three little kittens to go across the kitchen floor and jump up on a step into a living room and wander underneath a grand piano. And he said, so you can animate those three little kittens, toss along, and the floor is all moving and the walls, everything in is moving until you get on. And so I did all that, and it was all painted on cells, and it jittered like crazy. But he loved it. He thought it was a real good try.
Ken realized he was in for high adventure when Walt Disney told his artist the story of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Tell us a story.
Yes, tell us a story. A true story.
A love story.
Walt started in to tell his story, and he was a consummate actor. And in front of us, he wasn't embarrassed to do anything. And he became all these creatures. He had lived this story.
Let me see thy face.
Lit a fire under all of us. Every one of us worked Saturdays, Sundays, nights, everything else. We just loved it. Everything was new.
Ken was an art director on Snow White, and he made another major contribution to the movie.
And I said, well, I can wiggle my ears. And so then I started in, and I said, can you wiggle one at a time? And I said, sure. He said, wiggle the left one. So I wiggle the left one, wiggle the right one. And we got through doing that, and Walt said, hey, you know, that's a good idea. We could have Dopey wiggle his ears. But he could really wiggle them. He said, you can hardly move them, but Dopey could really wiggle them, you know. We all thought that Snow White was the biggest, the one and the only thing. That we were ever going to do. We never dawned on us that there was something else to do in life after Snow White.
But Disney's next creation was an even bigger challenge.
Pinocchio! P-I-N-U-O-P-I. We're wasting precious time. Come on to the theater!
I did a BD, an actor's life for me.
It was the flowering of the layout department and the background department. It was everybody flowered on Pinocchio, and I think each one of us drew on our own individual feeling as much as possible. Of course, there were places that you would go to find out details of architecture if you wanted to see how they really did it, but we kept trying to adapt it to make it more fairy tale so that you would never find anything exactly the way we did it in reality. It was just based on that flavor.
Ken's story sketches inspired the animators as they developed scenes for Pinocchio.
There was a scene where we wanted to glorify, bring things out and have a, we'd never visualized the blue fairy. So this was a story sketch, or a sketch showing the glow of the fairy materializing, having come through the window and bringing to life Geppetto's fondest dreams.
Geppetto, you have given so much happiness to others. You deserve to have your wish come true. Little puppet made of pine, wake. The gift of life is thine.
There's an island called Pleasure Island in Pinocchio where the boys, bad boys, went. And where Pinocchio changed into a jackass along with Lampwick. And, of course, poor little Jiminy Cricket, it was up to him to try to save his charge, Pinocchio. And so this is a layout of the saloon and the table. And after havoc has been wrecked already by what's happened to Pinocchio, and this is just a story idea. Then there was a time when Pinocchio apparently perished in the water, and Geppetto had to pray over Pinocchio's dead body. This is before Pinocchio became a real boy. So that demanded some sort of a mood in which you would feel for the sorrow of this old man having lost his boy.
My brave little boy.
Fantasia was Disney's most ambitious feature, and Walt assigned a different art director to each segment of the film.
And then within the Beethoven, there were different styles where you had the the opening business with the centaurs and the centaurettes. I wanted to get an early Greek Elysian Fields characteristic, sort of an Art Nouveau, which was very popular in France at one period. It was an idealistic setting, an idealistic period, where we felt that the, I felt that the centaurs and centaurettes would have a better chance to operate. But when Bacchus came in, that should be rollicking and wild and round and roly-poly. So we had I went for a different thing there, but it all was supposed to fit in one style, one overall style, a different treatment in the coloring and in some of the forms. I used fat, round forms, primarily in the Bacchus setups, because Bacchus himself, who was animated by Ward Kimball, was a fat, roly-poly, happy guy.
The imaginations of Ken and his fellow art directors brought Lewis Carroll's topsy-turvy landscape to life in Alice in Wonderland.
We did feel that it was in a world beyond our knowledge. We'd never seen a world like this. So what were we going to do to make people feel that this wasn't the real world? The part I enjoyed working on was the garden. The song of where there's the garden of flowers and the caterpillar and all that stuff.
Oh, that was lovely.
Thank you, my dear.
What kind of garden do you come from?
Oh, I don't come from any garden.
Do you suppose she's a wildflower? And did you notice her petals? What a peculiar color.
And no fragrance.
Just look at those stems.
Rather scrawny, I'd say.
I think she's pretty.
Quiet, bud.
But I'm not a flower.
Aha! Just as I suspected. A weed.
Disney's next assignment for his jack-of-all-trades, to perfect the combination of live actors and an animated world.
Song of the South was to be a combination. Again, I have to relate everything back to Walt, because Walt, I don't think it would have happened if it hadn't been that Walt Disney wanted to find the proper way to have humans and animals and cartoon characters work together on film and make us feel like they're in one world. We wanted to put Uncle Remus in a cartoon world. Have him walking around when he was telling these fantasy tales, he should really be transported himself into this cartoon world. So we built a set, a huge set, cartoon set, that we were intending to light as flat as we possibly could so that it looked like a painted cartoon background. We could then print into the live action backgrounds and into the set scenes, we could print our animation characters and they would appear to be long. It was the first time that had ever been done. But what it involved was, technically, it involved very, very close work with the head animators. And I made a book after book after book of miniatures, miniature scenes, and who did it and what. And they went down to the animators, and here's a section you're going to work on. Would you like to go over it in thumbnail form? Because Ken's going to go over and shoot this stuff. And so we would have different animators would either say, yeah, I like it just the way it is, or they would come up with suggestions for changes, and then we'd hash it out. And they loved it. They loved that way of working.
Doggone, that Red Rabbit is sure a caution. He sure is.
You mark my words. That's a fact. That young scamp is going to put his foot in it one of these days.
I didn't want to be stuck in animation. I didn't want to do only animation. I wanted to do story, I wanted to do painting, I wanted to do everything, be involved with everything. I loved being close to Walt, because Walt was where everything started.
Ken was in on Walt's first notions of Disneyland.
Ken, he said, you were an architect. He said, look, he said, I'm going to take you off the payroll. He said, you and I, I'll pay you out of my own pocket. He said, we'll take a room up here, and just you and I'll have the key. And, you know, and I want to get up there in that room, and you make these drapes. He said, why don't you make some things like Norman Rockwell covers? He said, I don't mean you have to make it that good, but that idea. Like, he loved Norman Rockwell. Make that kind of Americana, and then I'll build them and make these little creatures that you put in there, make them move, make them work. And we had keys to this little room on the third floor, and only he and I. And I would make I made about 25 of these paintings and covers. And he completed three, built them. Because what happened was, the first one I did was a little old stage with a soft shoe dancer on it. And I thought that'd be a nice simple thing, just a little proscenium arch and all the little kerosene lamps. And this guy with a checkered suit was standing there doing a little soft shoe dance. And Walt looked at us and said, "Hey, I know who can do that. That's Buddy Ebsen. He's a friend of mine. He'll do it." In the meantime, he and I would go downtown to a pressed wood factory, because I had this proscenium arch with a certain scale and design in it. And he never asked me. He said, "Here's what we want for the proscenium arch, Ken." And he pulled out, and it was just god-awful. It was all wrong. It was twice the scale it should be. It would make the stage look like a terrible place. But I couldn't say, "Oh, no, that's the wrong scale." If he couldn't see what I had drawn and how wrong the size of what he had picked out and the shape of what he had picked out was. But you know, the odd thing was that he picked out this awful, execrable thing, and it looked good. In the long run, I put it there, "Wow, how did that happen?" You know?
Ken moved back into animation to help shape the storybook style of a new picture.
I came on Sleeping Beauty a little late. It was styled by Ivan Earle, who has become a famous artist in his own right. Walt liked his style. If you look at the old master Van Eyck, you can see details on bushes miles away, as if everything in the whole picture is absolutely clear. And Ivan felt that way about this. It's a fairy tale. Let's make it like that. You'll notice that all the design in it is absolutely vertical or horizontal. Everything in it is based on these two juxtapositions, these two planes, including the characters. It's all just lovely, pristine, horizontal, vertical, very, very designy.
There was a price for Sleeping Beauty's elegance, a price that was too high.
I understood that Walt was very, very unhappy with the $8.5 million, which Sleeping Beauty cost, and the rumor was we weren't going to make any more feature pictures. They were too expensive. Well, by putting together a number of things that appealed to me, I could apply to Walt that yes, we could make a picture for $3 million, and he had a project that he wanted to do anyway, which was 101 Dalmatians.
One of the most expensive steps in animation was the tracing of the drawings onto clear sheets of celluloid or cells.
Drawing that you make as an animator or anybody, you start to make a drawing, and that drawing has what life, because it's drawn right out of your mind. You're not thinking about your technique, your hand, or anything else. It's just a whole picture coming to life out of your hand. Now, if somebody, including yourself, is given the chore of tracing that, immediately it becomes dead.
Addison conceived a Xerox system that reproduced the animator's drawings on celluloid.
Happy dogs and dogs will eat new trenches, canine crunchies.
Ready? We better get these little nickels off to bed.
A difference in the appearance of the 101 Dalmatians from any of the pictures preceding it was that you will be aware of the fact that there are lines, drawing lines, outlining every character and actually even outlining many of the areas in the background. These things you were never conscious of, and they didn't exist in the feature pictures prior to that.
Walt Disney didn't care for the look of the movie, and he knew Ken was responsible.
We got that whole doggone thing practically done before he discovered what we were doing, and then I realized what a heinous crime I'd committed in his name, because he said no more of that 101 Dalmatian stuff.
It was after 101 Dalmatians that Ken suffered a severe physical calamity threatening not only his career, but his life.
I was practically given up for dead after a very traumatic experience that I'd had 15 years ago now, and was unable to move. I had a stroke. I couldn't move. I was paralyzed, of course. I couldn't see. And after being discharged from the hospital, it was hard not to give up. But my wife, bless her soul, she and I had loved this lovely place before, brought me down here in the car, and I was just a lump. And it's a terrible thing, really. I don't want to get carried away by it, but if you have absolutely no control over your body, you don't know what to talk, what to think about to make something move, it's a terrible situation. Somehow or other, these trees inspired me. The fact that they can do that, if they can manage to contort themselves into these lovely shapes, if they are so strong as to hold themselves at this great weight out of these impossible angles, and they evidence such a love of life, Then certainly I could. I didn't actively think these words, but I know that something of that nature must have inspired me because I was able to actually negotiate with my wife's help three steps. I really couldn't have felt more exultation if I had conquered climbing Mount Everest than those first three steps, because that led to the next three the next day and six more, and then finally walking and finally trotting and finally a rejuvenation and a redirection of my life. And it was brought about, I'm pretty certain, by this marvelous atmosphere, this environment of this nature.
Ken returned to the studio in time to add life to the exotic atmosphere in the Jungle Book.
One day in a meeting, Walt turned to me and he said, "Well, Ken, it's time for you to come up with Shere Khan," which of course stopped me in my tracks, and I agonized that night until I thought in terms of Basil Rathbone, who to me was a very menacing, underplayed villain. So I made these drawings of the tiger with that attitude, supercilious, so confident of his power, so confident of his ability that he didn't need to rant and roar, and made these drawings and showed them to Walt the next day, and he said, "Hey, that's it." He said, "I know who that is. That's George Sanders." He said, "And he's a friend of mine. He'll do it."
I'd like a word with you, if you don't mind.
Shere Khan, what a surprise.
Yes, isn't it? I just dropped by. Forgive me if I've interrupted anything.
Oh, no, nothing at all.
I thought perhaps you were entertaining someone up there in your coils. Who is it, Carl?
No. Well, I was just singing to myself.
Indeed.
Walt Disney never saw Jungle Book completed. 10 months before its release, he walked through his studio for the last time.
I met him on the day that he escaped from the deathbed at the hospital. And he came into the studio, and he seemed to have shrunk. He wasn't supposed to. He was supposed to be taken home to die. And I didn't know all that. I just ran into him, and I was so grateful and glad to see him. I said, "Gee, it's good to see you, Walt." He said, "Ken, it's sure good to be here." And then he looked at me and penetratingly with the eyes, and I knew that he was forgiving me for this thing I had done on Dalmatians. He didn't say anything, but I know I was forgiven, that as far as he was concerned, it wasn't so bad, after all. So it meant a lot to me. And then I found out, of course, 2 weeks later, he was gone.
Walt Disney now gone, there remained a question. Would Disney Animation survive? Ken Anderson had the answer.
I thought I'd put everything together. What did the animators most enjoy doing? They most enjoyed working in the manner in which we worked on Song of the South. Where could I get animal creatures that were somewhat like Song of the South, and what kind of a picture, sort of a charade, a burlesque of some well-known fantasy story or some picture? What would be a Robin Hood? Aha. And what is it that an animal would be best suited for but a fox, a wily fox, a little fellow who's being preyed on by the Sheriff of Nottingham and then I thought, King Richard, lion-hearted, the lion and his sneaky little half-brother, Prince John, who's an undernourished lion, and this Sir Hiss, the snake, and the Sheriff of Nottingham is a wolf, and all these things. And it was a good, fun picture to work on.
For the Aristocats, Ken created an entire cast of cats.
Each one of them suggests some sort of a human characteristic. Of course, the Siamese.
Shanghai, Hong Kong, Egg Foo Young. Fortune cookie, always wrong. Not the hot one.
And the Russian musical composer, this is Stravinsky.
Let's rock the joint.
Groove it, cats.
Here we have the transient, or the bum. And the society, high society, and fashion model.
Not all of Ken's cats showed up in the finished film, but they clearly inspired the animators to put on a swinging show.
Everybody, everybody, everybody wants to be your cat.
Hold the belly up. Now, boy.
Dragons are nothing new to Disney. Anderson manufactured a different kind of fire breather for Pete's Dragon in 1977.
So I thought, why not a big bumbling Wallace Beery type of dragon? A guy who can't shave all the time. He's got stubble on his beard, on his chin, and yet he's warm-hearted, but crude. And also it'd be kind of nice if he wasn't really able to be facile, wasn't able to fly too well. He'd allowed himself to get a little paunchy. And so no longer were his wings capable of lifting him off the ground without a great deal of effort, which would make people feel a little bit for the dragon if he was a nice fellow.
I don't want to play.
Today, when you think there are no more mountains for him to climb, Ken Anderson's many travels have led to a new challenge, designing the African Pavilion for Epcot Center.
This was born of the African trip, although it had nothing to do with any one thing I actually saw in Africa. This is a summation of all many, many things from both East Africa and West Africa, which would make and done on purpose that way, so that no one country in Africa could say, hey, that's from Kenya. Here's another view of the Africa Pavilion. Anybody from any part of Africa, from just Sub-Sahara to South Africa, could claim that at least one of these buildings certainly inspired by his area.
Of all the faraway lands he has visited, one spot remains most special to Ken Anderson.
This is my laughing place. Remember Brer Rabbit? Uncle Remus's Brer Rabbit? Brer Rabbit had a laughing place. Everybody should have a laughing place. This is certainly mine. Filled me with life. These trees, the strength, the grace, the beauty of these California live oak trees is something that just inspires me every minute. In fact, it means life to me. Actually, literally, figuratively, and really means life.